Every praise is to our God. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord on a Sunday morning? I don't know about you, but I am glad to be in the house because I don't know what's going to happen, but I know something's going to happen. You may have come in here with the need of health, finances, spiritual, mental, whatever it might be, but I believe our God is here to answer whatever need that is in the house. Do you believe that this morning? So why don't we lift up the name of the Lord just a little bit more? Why don't we worship him in his sanctuary? God, you are worthy.
Miracle,
just a little bit more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 As you remain standing, let us go to the Lord in prayer. They're going to put some needs on the overhead. If you have a need, let it be known by the uplifting of your hands. If you would like to be prayed for, you can come forward and let the elders of the church pray for you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we ask you, Lord, that you'll touch these needs. Dear Lord, we give you God.
Oh,
Praise the Lord. You may be seated if I can get the ushers to come for the offering. I just have two announcements to remind everybody about. November 11th, everybody say Fall Fest. We have a Fall Fest November 11th. We are asking for those that are coming to go ahead and sign up in the foyer with any kind of side dishes that you will be bringing. Once again, that's November 11th. And then our last connection group will be a painting group. That is November 11th. So if you haven't signed up for that, I would suggest you do that pretty soon. If we could worship the Lord one more time.
Seated, and I'm going to let him carry them, because I've said this a lot lately, but the cry of the hour is strength. I just need strength to stand. And God said, I'll give you strength. I'll be your strength. Amen. I've shared this story a lot, but mankind has been to the Marianas Trench twice, maybe three times. Marianas Trench is the deepest part of the ocean. It's in the Pacific. It's 35,000 feet deep. The pressure there is about 15,000 pounds per square inch. All of you remember from your chemistry and your physics, every 34 foot of water is 14.7 pounds of pressure. So that's one atmosphere. So divide 34 into 35,000, you get about 1,100 times 14.7, you get about 15,000 PSI. That's a lot of pressure. That is unfathomable pressure. But friend, when they went down to the Marianas Trench, guess what they found? Fish. It was the worst environment. It's frigid cold. It's dark, a Stygian darkness. And friend, they were under 15,000 pounds of pressure. But they were just swimming around. You know why? Because the pressure in the fish was equal to the pressure outside the fish. And the Lord said, I'll be in you. I'll give you strength. And friend, I'm going to tell you what, right now, you call upon the Lord. God said, I'll be your strength. I'll go before you. I'll be your refuge. You're not going to lose your mind. You're not going down. Thank God. God said, I'll be your God. You just call on me. Amen. And if we don't do anything else this morning, we're going to call on the name of the Lord. Because God said, I'll be your God. Amen. Friend, you're not going to lose your mind. You're going to have a sound mind. And if there's any fear in this room this morning, I rebuke it in the name of Jesus Christ. God said, I'll be with you. I'll provide for you. I'll go before you. Thank God. And all I need to do is keep my mind stayed on Him. I think that's the greatest challenge we face today, is all the distractions. I mean, you look at what's going on. I mean, just everything. And if that's not enough, then your phones entertain you enough. Generally with 99.9% bad. But the Bible said if you'll just keep your mind stayed on the Lord, then the Lord will give you peace. Amen. Beautiful morning. It's good to be in church. You look better when you go to church. And for most of us, I need all the help I can get. I can tell you OJ's beauty lotion doesn't take away freckles. Because when I was a young boy, I had freckles, and I didn't want freckles. I found out later freckles are little suntans that haven't gotten together yet. But I didn't like them as a boy, so I convinced my mother to buy some OJ's beauty lotion. I don't know where I'd heard about it, but and she didn't want it, but she may have figured she probably figured out what was doing. She put it in the cabinet. Me and my brother at night splashing OJ's beauty lotion on her face. Found out later it was nothing but alcohol, and it won't remove freckles. So I gave up on looking better. But you do look better when you go to church. And thank all of you for coming to the house of the Lord. And we welcome you on this beautiful Sunday morning. This is the day the Lord has made. And I won't take a lot of announcements, but I do need to mention our children's rally that was scheduled for this Tuesday night, the 31st. We've rescheduled that till December the 2nd, so that'll be a little ways away. But our children's ministry director, Brother Wilson, for the section, has rescheduled that. So Fall Fest, Greg mentioned that. That's November 11th. You need to come. Bring your family. That's all free. It's 5 o'clock. November the 11th, we're going to have a great time. Also, calendars, see those for November. Get those out. I do want to congratulate Brother Ken, Sister Lynn Means. They had a wonderful celebration last night for their 35th wedding anniversary and Sister Lynn's 60th birthday. I'm not sharing a confidence. She shared it, so I'm just repeating. But I told them last night, they make that look easy. And so, I bring you good news. Time changes back next Sunday. That's good news because it's spring forward and fall back. Well, we're in the fall, so we get that extra hour. And for all of us sleep-deprived people, enjoy. Mary had a little lamb it was given her to keep, and then it became a Pentecostal and died from lack of sleep. So y'all enjoy that 1 hour. Next Saturday night. Don't stay up late. Just get your extra hour. And enjoy that. I do want to mention quickly, too, we've had two homegoing services or lost. And Sister Shauna's father, Dale Troy, and his senior, passed away yesterday. And Sister Shauna's not here, but her dad, 68 years old. His service will be this Friday here at the church at 5 o'clock. Visitation 4 to 5. So if you're able to come and be with Sean and the family. And then the next day, we'll be with Sister Kelly Crawford. Her mother, Sandy Crawford, passed away, and her celebration is 2 o'clock here at the church this Saturday. So two services, Friday and Saturday, for these two families. Pray for all of them, that God would just be with them and comfort them. And it's not a matter if, just when. And eternity, somebody said, it's not a matter of eternity, it's location. Because we're headed to eternity. It's just the address. And if I need, there's 1,000 reasons I'm in church, but that's one of them. Man, I want to go to heaven, don't you? And we do all this to hear 7 words. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. I conclude you got to be good, and I'm only good through him, and I got to be faithful. And only servants go to heaven, because that's what he's going to record us for, is well done, a good and faithful servant. Amen. Would you stand with me? I hate to transition into this preaching after that, but all of that. But it's an honor to have this man that's coming to this pulpit. We appreciate Brother Mark Morgan. Many of you don't know him, but to say that God has used him is an understatement. He hears from God, and I appreciate his walk with God. Brother Morgan has filled many roles in the ministry. He's been a pastor. He's been a district superintendent, president of what's called Global Impact Ministries, which is a ministry literally around the world. He's preached conferences, crusades, ministry events, ministerial training all over the world. He was just in Australia a week or two ago. He travels every day, every week, every time. And we appreciate that. He was part of our World Network of Prayer Summits in New Orleans Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And we appreciate all of you that were able to go. But Brother Morgan had a vision for revival in what's called the I-10 corridor. I-10 goes from California to Florida. This man's had a burden, and he's united the saints of God. And yesterday we had, we call it a simulcast, and they brought showed it on the screen. You there saw it. Churches praying from California to Florida at the same time for a breakthrough in the I-10 corridor. And we're just believing for an apostolic breakthrough of revival, because that encompasses some of the largest cities, and New Orleans being one of those. And this man has had that burden and carried it. He is making a difference for the kingdom. It's an honor to have him. Would you make him welcome, Brother Mark Morgan? Amen.
Well, the Lord certainly blessed you when he gave you Brother Brian as your pastor. Amen. 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 God bless you in the name of the Lord. Amen. Thank you, sir. Nobody likes a dry preacher. Amen. All right. Good morning, everybody. Do we need to do head and shoulders, knees and toes this morning? Get us all awake. Some of you don't have any idea what I'm talking about. Most of you do. I told them yesterday, I said, if we tried to do it today, mine would be head and shoulders, knees and knees. I don't know that I could touch my toes. Amen. And so, but it's a delight to be here this morning. And I said it and I mean it. I appreciate Brother Brian, knowing him through the years. One thing that I think about Brother Brian is consistency. And I also think of a Christian. I hate to tell you this, but I've met a few preachers. They weren't good good Christians. Well, it went over real well. Amen. But it's a delight when you get a good preacher and a good Christian. So I think that's what God has blessed you with. I give honor to him and to his family here today. Amen. It's good to feel the presence of God. All right. I don't know what time you normally get out. If I know how things work, being raised in the Midwest, we need to get out of here so we can beat the Baptists to the restaurants. I'll try to keep that in mind. Amen. Revelation chapter 22, verse number 1. Revelation 22 and 1. He shewed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. There shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. Amen. I want to talk to you today about altars and thrones. Altars and thrones. I'll explain that a little bit better to you here in just a few minutes. Amen. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for this service. Thank you for the honor of standing in this pulpit to minister to your people. I pray that you help us today, God. Let it flow out of our hearts in purity. I ask you to give me clarity of mind. I pray that you would confirm your word here today with signs following. We exercise your authority in this service today in the name of Jesus. And everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. I think probably, I'll come to that here in just a second. Amen. Brother Brian alluded to it, and I want to just give you a little history. Now, this is going to sound weird, and so all you analytical people, I'm probably going to lose you right here. Several years ago, I would say probably 1989, maybe 90, the Lord gave me a vision. In the vision, I seen this twirling, massive ball of fire hurling toward the earth. I was passing that time in a little rural town in Oklahoma called Okmulgee, Oklahoma. Anybody ever been there? Oh, got one back there. Oh, yeah. You can go to heaven now. You've been to Okmulgee. And I just couldn't seem to really get a breakthrough, a spiritual breakthrough. And so in that vision, I watched when that ball of fire broke into the earth's hemisphere, it just kind of splintered. And I watched as these balls of fire were going to geographical areas. I then watched the main one as it come over the community. I seen it over the church, and then I'm standing in the church, and I see that ball of fire hit in front of the pulpit. And when it hit in front of the pulpit, out of it came thousands of angels with swords drawn, and the Lord spoke and said, "The darkness will not prevail against the light." If there was ever a time that we need to be reminded of that, it's in 2023. If you're not careful, you get the feeling that darkness is prevailing. Psalmist said, "When I seen the prosperity of the wicked, my foot well nigh slipped." That doesn't mean their wealth. That means it looks like wickedness was prospering and getting by. Until I went into the house of the Lord and I seen the end thereof. The enemy always has a way of trying to project to you that he's prospering. That evil is prospering. Wickedness is prospering. Especially in America right now. But you know what? There's an end. And you have to go to the house of the Lord and see the end thereof. And then the revelation comes that the darkness will not prevail against the light. When it's all said and done, God will still be on the throne. That ought to put a little shout in you right there. When it's all said and done, light. Amen. Now, years later, the Lord gave me another vision about the same thing. But this time coming out of it was not angels coming with swords drawn, but it was young men coming out of it with Bibles in their hands. And the Lord impressed me then that this is how I will set America on fire. I will fire up the churches, the local churches, and coming out of that fire will be fiery evangelists. I'm not talking about card-carrying evangelists. I'm talking about you. And coming out of that will be fiery evangelists, and everything that is combustible that they touch will ignite. Oh, boy. Then the Lord gave me the third part of it. When I asked him one day, I said, "How do we get the fire?" He said, "It's simple, just follow the steps of Elijah." So Elijah gathers them together. He made fun of all the false prophets. I mean, you ought to read some different translations of that. It's very interesting. He's just got to mocking them, antagonizing them. "Where is your God? Perhaps he's on a vacation." Maybe he's asleep. One translation says, I think you went to the bathroom. And I mean, he just, and then of course they had all day, and then time of the evening sacrifice, Elijah walked up. Now watch what happens. He took 12 stones, which were the 12 tribes, what the Bible says. So in other words, before they were tribes, before they were districts, before they were sections, they were a family. Meaning that the altar must be attended by the family. That's what we attempted to do yesterday, is bring the family of God together and allow them to build this altar, because we're expecting the fire of God to fall. He built it. He placed the sacrifice on it. He saturated it with water. What was it? 12 barrels of water, the most precious commodity in the land. They're in a drought. And he takes that water. No doubt they thought he's just wasting it. It's such a precious commodity and you're wasting it. No. What I'm doing is I am removing the ability for anybody to say, we started it. Good. 63-word prayer. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'll explain it even clearer here in just a second. If you build an altar, it doesn't take much prayer. Well, that went over real well. Now, understand, I know that in Pentecost, when you say altar, it is synonymous with prayer. That's not really true. The altar is not a place of prayer. The altar is a place of death. See, you can pray and not have an altar, which means you pray amiss. Maybe we should dismiss now and go to the restaurant. Amen. And the whole deal is that we just think, well, I pray and everything's fine. Well, as the scripture says, and I've already quoted, you can pray amiss. Now, how do you pray amiss? You pray amiss when you're praying out of your own will. The altar is a place where something dies and something is sacrificed. The fire of God will not fall on a barren altar. It's just not going to happen. I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago, I was in Zanesville, Ohio, preaching for Brother Bounds, Aaron Bounds, and we had tongues interpretation that night. The young man that gave it was not aware of all this other stuff, and he said, you've asked me where the fire is. He said, according to my word, the fire is reserved in the heavens, which is in the epistle of Peter. He says that God destroyed the first world with water. He's going to destroy the second act of his judgment against the world will be with fire. The same water that destroyed the world saved Noah. Same water. That's why we're saved. That's why he went back to the story and said, we are saved by water, which meaning back to the story of Noah. Water moved him from an old world to a new world. Now, if you understand the typology of that, that's talking about baptism. You are saved by baptism. Why is it important? Because as Noah, you go into the ark in the old world, the ark, and water moves you into a new world. That's what water baptism does. I'll go a step further in case somebody needs to hear it. Anybody know what the sign was that there was a new world? Dove? Isn't that correct? A dove? What do you think happened in the waters of baptism when Jesus comes up out of the water and the Holy Ghost come descending like unto a dove? It was God signifying, I'm creating a whole new world right now. That's why you're a new creature in Christ Jesus. I get tickled when people tell me I'm an ex-addict, I'm an ex-whatever. I think sometimes people just want to let you know that because that becomes their identity. They have a lot of pride in what they used to be. Well, that went over too. I hate to tell you, but something new doesn't have past. So when you come to God, you're no longer an ex anything. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. They're dead. Behold, all things become new. All right. I don't want to get bogged down there. Now, here's the deal. If you look at it, the altar is where you present yourself, and especially your will, which is the hardest thing you will ever do, is to pray the same thing that Jesus prayed, nonetheless. Not my will be done, but your will be done. That happens in the garden when you're on your way to the cross. When you're on your way to the altar, you've got to determine. Now, here's the thing. I don't care how long you've been serving God. I don't care how long you've been about this. If you're not careful, you become self-willed again. And everybody wants to rule. You want to be king of your own life. You want to call the shots of your own life. Why in the world do you think when it says confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, what that's really saying is you just took yourself off the throne of your life and you put him on it? It's not just a mere verbal confession, I accept that Jesus Christ is Lord. Well, I mean, you could spout off all you want to spout, but what really makes him Lord in your life is when you are no longer Lord of your life and he becomes King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In other words, he's going to rule my life. I'm going to subject myself to his will. I'm going to subject myself to his word, which is his expressed will. Somebody said, I just wish I knew the will of God. Well, I'll help you. Logos, thought of God. So, guys, I want to share my thoughts with you. I want to share with you what I'm like. I want to share with you what pleases me. So he gave us the Bible. I get tickled when people say, I was praying the other day asking God if I should do this and do that, and I'm waiting on God to answer. And they know they've read it in the Bible. What do you think? God's going to contradict his own word and make an exception to you? You really, boy, I'm getting off on a rough start here. You really think you're that important? That God says, now for everybody else, they got to do this. But you are the exception to the rule. Oh, boy, oh, boy. Where are we going to eat? Now, the altar is where, let me give you a verse to substantiate what I'm saying. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. All that was mentioned before is a reasonable service. Don't let anybody ever tell you that God's unreasonable. It is your reasonable service. This, what he's saying is that this is the true act of worship, which is reasonable. Now, then he goes and says this, don't be conformed to this world, but rather be transformed by the renewing of your minds, that you might prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. So you tie verse 1 to verse 2 because the only way that you will ever find the will of God is by presenting yourself as a living sacrifice. It's going to make sense here in just a second. You will never know the will of God until you take your will, put it on the altar, and let the fire of God fall and consume it. But God doesn't leave it empty. He puts his will. Don't be conformed to this world, but rather be you transformed by the renewing of your minds, which means a better mind. You're getting rid of your old way of thinking. You're getting rid of your old mind, and you're about to take on the mind of Christ, and you're about to take on the will of God. Now go prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Now, I don't know what Brother Brian teaches. If he teaches something different than this, he's right and I'm wrong. But the deal is, I don't think there's three categories to the will of God. I don't remember what game show this used to be, but there was a curtain. And you want curtain number one? You want curtain number two? Or you want curtain number three? I don't think that's how God wants us to approach his will. You want this good, you want this acceptable, or you want this perfect? Well, I take the good. I don't know what's included in the perfect. And so a lot of us approach God that way. But the fact is, once God takes over your thinking and you subject your will to him, then you go prove what is the will of God, which is all. It's good, acceptable, and it's perfect. Is this too much like the Bible study? I don't want you going to sleep now. Amen. We'll do head and shoulders, knees and toes. Now, I keep forgetting, most of you don't have any idea. How many of you know what head and shoulders, knees and toes is? Oh, yeah. You act like you don't know what I'm talking about, amen. There's a whole lot of you here. Now, let's advance a little bit. So the altar is where it's a raised platform. I think, now Brother Brian could probably explain this because people like him just got such brilliant minds, and this, he's spouting off stuff a while ago, and I'm like, oh dear God. I got a long ways to go to be like Brother Brian. Amen. But here's what I see: an altar. It is, if you study it, it is a raised, and you got to be careful, it's called like a raised platform. So to me, it is a raised awareness in my thinking that there could be something else. I don't know how else to explain it. I am going to at least entertain the possibility that I could be wrong. Oh boy, there wasn't 90% of you right there. I'm never wrong. You were wrong right there. She's my wife, and I know you heard us before. I said, I knew I was marrying the right one. I just didn't know your first name was always. Well, I'm really getting off to a good start here today. I won't tell you what she said back. Amen. Now, here's the deal. You've got to be willing to go to the throne, or you got to be willing to go to the altar, and I'll tell you why. If I don't know who's doing that, I probably should have gave you this verse, but if you'll put up there Revelation chapter 8 and verse number 3. I got to get down there where I can see it. All right. Everybody good? Is that how long I've been preaching? 18 minutes. Jesus, help us. All right, we got it? That's not it. You going to do it old school? There you go. Another angel came, stood at the altar, having the golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. Now, if you'll start studying the scripture, you will notice that there's many places that the throne of God is mentioned, but in close proximity is an altar. And I'm going to tell you right now, it is impossible for you to get to the throne without going by the altar. The throne is where the king rules and speaks and shares his will with you. There's a reason why that a lot of people don't know the will of God for their lives. It's because they don't have an altar. I have people come up all the time, Brother Morgan, you got a word for me? Yeah, I got a word for you. Go get your own. You know, people like that tell me, you're too lazy to get to the throne yourself. You want me to go get it for you. Yeah, I'm convinced that we got prophetic junkies in Pentecost. They just go from conference to conference seeking a word. I just need a word. Somebody give me a word. Better be careful living your life like that, because somebody will give you a word, but it won't be the right one. And then you're going to get derailed, and you're going to get messed up, and then you're going to get deluded. I've had people try to prophesy to me. Matter of fact, this one guy called me. I was in Oklahoma, and he said, Brother Morgan, God said you got 30 days to leave that church because he's getting ready to write Ichabod above the door of it. Well, to be honest with you, I was excited about receiving that word. That meant I could get out of town. And so my wife come to pick me up for lunch. I was at the church praying a little bit. My wife come pick me up for lunch. She said, what's wrong? I said, well, I'm kind of troubled. Well, why are you troubled? I said, well, this is what the guy said. And I don't want to confuse you or paint, but he's supposed to have been a prophet. So I just accepted what he said. She said, well, I don't understand that. She's the practical one. I'm way out here, you know, twilight zone. She's the one who's got her feet on the ground. And she said, well, I don't understand that. I said, why? She said, well, Sunday night you preached about what God's getting ready to do. There was such a strong witness of the Spirit. She said, has God changed his mind since Sunday night? And then she said, Mark, God's not bipolar. He said, you better call an elder. So I picked the phone up. I called an elder, a man that I had a tremendous amount of trust and respect for. And I told him what happened. And this is his response. You ready for it? Mark, my God, are you backslid? Now, I was glad to report that day I wasn't. Now, most days I am, but that day I'd been in prayer. And he said, why does God have to put your mail in somebody else's mailbox? See, in the Old Testament, we needed prophets to speak for God. But in the New Testament, God should be able to speak to you directly. There's still prophets in the church. I believe that very strong. And I believe that God does use them to speak to his people. But I see them operating more in affirmation or confirmation. I refuse to live my life as somebody walking up and just giving me a word. And then me just, okay, and here I go. I'm just not going to do that. I'll take what they say, follow it away, and say, okay, I'm going to pray about it, and let's see if it comes to pass. But I'm not about to change my whole life over something you told me. Boy, that... I got to get out of this quicksand I'm in. Now, have you ever heard the statement from Proverbs? I read it this morning. A man's gift will make room for him and bring him before great men. You ever heard that? Now, most time when that's quoted, we're talking to somebody, need to be patient. I know God's given you a ministry, but just be patient. One of these days, God's going to give you a platform. I mean, that's the way I viewed it most of my adult life. I was a little shocked the other day to read something that changed my whole outlook on that verse, meaning that the only way that you can get into the presence of a great man, especially a king, is you had to bring him a gift. You knew better than try to approach a great man without bringing him a gift. I am convinced that the only way that you can get to the throne of God is by giving him a gift, and that gift is you. It's you. Now, let me say this, and then I'll get to the positive stuff. Years ago, I was in a revival, and God shared something with me, and I know I've already alluded to visions, and that spooks a lot of people, but I was in a church preaching. You know Brother Shatwell, David Shatwell? I was preaching, sir? Yeah. I was preaching for Brother Shatwell, and it was at the close of service. He just took the church in Okemah, Oklahoma. And it's just kind of a weird deal because the whole auditorium out here just went kind of blank. And then right in the middle of it was this throne, and there's this ugly, hideous-looking something sitting on the throne. The impression I got was all kinds of creepy, crawly stuff. And I heard the Lord speak to me that night and say, as of this night, I will destroy the throne of iniquity in this church, and I will raise up a throne of righteousness. So my custom is, if I feel like God spoke something to me, I'm going to go find it in the Bible. So I went home, went to studying it out, and sure enough, there's a mention to a throne of righteousness in the scripture, and there's a mention of a throne of iniquity. Now, here's the deal. Iniquity, some people say it's just lawlessness. No, it's more than that. It's broader than that. It is you removing the law of God and inserting your own. Yeah, I don't like that. This is what I think. Well, where the word of a king is, there's power. And the next part of that verse, and who can question it? In other words, who would be bold enough to ask the king why? When kings tell you, see, we're in America. We don't understand this. We got presidents, not kings. Somebody needs to tell some of them what to do. I tell you. I'm not going there. Amen. But with kingships and kingdoms, kings don't take public opinion polls and ask what the will of the people is. He speaks, he gives it, and they just do it. Even if it means to their own detriment, they still had to do it. If they didn't, it was treason and off your head. Now, the same thing applies to God. If we establish, now let me just say this. Pastor Brian is not the one to determine in this church what throne will rule it. That's up to you. When Moses come down off the mountain, he comes down there three times. He said, this is what God said. And three times the people said, we will hearken and we will obey. And at the third time, the Bible says the heavens opened. And Moses and the 70 elders were allowed to see into the heavens, and they seen the throne of God. See, they could see the throne of God when the people said, amen. We will hearken and we will obey. See, when the congregation decides that what he's preaching and teaching, we will hearken to it and we will obey it. What you're doing is you are establishing a throne of righteousness in this congregation. Matter of fact, I'll take it further than that. You have to decide what throne's going to rule in your life. I can't decide that for you. You have to decide, am I going to remove God's law in my life and replace it with my own and what I think and what I want to do? Or am I going to obey the word of God? Whew, I'm starting to feel like the Lone Ranger up here. Amen. And one of the truest tests of true worship is truth, which means sincerity. You are not a true worshiper if you're not worshiping out of sincerity and honesty. You can say all day long, I'm sincere, but you don't know you're sincere until he presents something to you that you have the power to reject or to accept. And you better be careful when you start rejecting truth. You got any money in your pocket? You have any money in your purse? Now we know who rules that house. Can I borrow your money? No, just empty it out. I want everything you got. Yeah. What's that? Oh, she said it's everywhere in my purse. Good Lord, I hit the jackpot. You know she has that in her purse?
Yeah, it's my money.
Oh, it's your money.
It's all her money.
I feel her getting stirred up right now. All right. Oh, God have mercy. Oh, this is good enough. All right. I don't know how much is here. All right. Thank you. Now, Brother Brian, that's how you take up an offering right there. Got any money? Give it to me. Now. All right. Here's the deal. Jesus gave us a parable about the sower and the word. He says, and to he who hath, shall more be given to. Right? We have it back. And to he who hath not, which is you now, shall what he hath be taken and given to another. Now, how can you be a have not and something be taken from you? I've been trying to tell that to the IRS for years. I am a have not. Why do you keep trying to take something?
Yeah.
Let me tell you what Jesus was saying. You ready for it? Hold that. He was saying that I'm going to keep, as long as you accept my word and truth, I'll keep giving you truth. But the moment that you reject it and you tell me, no, I'm not only going to withdraw that, see, you don't, truth is not a buffet or a smorgasbord where you get to walk up there and say, I want that, I want that, and I want that, but I don't want that. Truth is like a fine woven tapestry. You got to accept it all. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. Thank you. Man. Everybody still good? Oh, Jesus. All right, now here's the deal. Let's get to where we need to go now. I notice in the scripture, I've preached about that fire for 30-something years. And then a few weeks ago, the Lord said, there's something else about that with Elijah. Fire falls and then rain comes. So I'm convinced that the fire of God falls at the altar. That's where it falls. I was going back to Brother Aaron Bounds. Tongue's interpretation was, you asked me where the fire is. My fire is reserved in the heavens. And the only thing my fire seeks is an altar. See, the fire of God is called a consuming fire.
Right, right.
In other words, when it falls to consume something. The difference between false fire and the fire of God is false fire doesn't consume anything. It's just a sensational show. But the true fire of God, when it falls, there's got to be something on the altar. There's got to be something there that it can consume. So if we really want the fire of God to come into our churches, which consumes, according to Peter, consumes unrighteousness. Let me put it to you like this, okay? You can burn now or you can burn later. But you're going to burn one way or the other. And the same fire, just as water with Noah, the same fire that destroyed, or the same water that destroyed the world saved Noah, is the same way with fire. The fire of God that's going to destroy the world saves you. Because Peter said when it's all said and done, he's going to melt the world with the fervent heat. He's going to consume it with fire. And all unrighteousness will be eliminated. It's gone. So I want the fire of God to come into my life now. And I want it to begin to consume any unrighteousness, any leaven, anything that's not right. I want it to be consumed in my life right now. Everybody good? The throne. Now get ready, I'm fixing to give this whole service to you guys. The throne, I read to you, out of the throne proceeds a river. It's a pure river of life. And it flows down the street of that city. And beside it are these trees. 12 fruit. Every month it yields fruit. And then there's leaves that are for the healing of the nations. Now if you read that whole scenario is. Here's the key to it. You ready? The key to it is the throne and who is sitting on the throne. I don't know why people get confused about how many gods there are. Because all you got to do is read Revelation 22. If three co-equal, co-eternal, co-existent, then I'm just going to tell you right now, the Father and the Holy Ghost got ripped off. They don't get a throne. Which denies co-equality. There's only one throne. And Revelation 22 says, I'll tell you who's sitting on that throne. God and the Lamb, which is Jesus Christ, who is now King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And coming out of that revelation, coming out of that understanding, proceeds this river. Ooh. See, when you enthrone him in your life, you put him on the throne in your life, you get the revelation of who he is. You also get his name written in your forehead. But here's the deal. A river flows. It's a river of life. It brings spirit life and it brings healing. When we get to the throne, fire's at the altar. When we get to the throne, it's a river. And that river brings life and it brings healing. Ooh. Which is exactly what your family needs, what your community needs, what this nation and the globe needs. It needs a river of life flowing, and there needs to be healing. Would you agree? All right, I'm about to wrap it up. I got you all set up right where I want you. Well, we want that river to flow from the throne. Listen, it starts in Genesis with the river. It ends in Revelation 22 with the river. See, the only way to get into the Holy of Holies is you had to go by the altar. You can't get in there. And that the Holy of Holies, where the mercy seat is, that's called the throne room of God. That's Revelation chapter 8. You got to take the burning censer. You got to take fire. That's the only way you can get in there. You don't have that, you're not getting in there. A lot of people learn to live their whole spiritual existence in the holy place, but not the Holy of Holies. Outer court, flesh, holy place, emotional, soulish arena, holy of holies, spirit. A lot of people go past the first, get to the first one, the altar, the brazen altar outside, and they get into the holy place, which gives them shoe bread and candlesticks, which is natural light and spiritual light. So they learn to live in that soulish, emotional arena for God. But they never visit the Holy of Holies. Oh, I feel Jesus. Well, you're supposed to feel him. I'm tearing this thing up, Brother Brian. I come to church because I like what I feel. Well, I hate to tell you. And for all you people that I get tickled with people saying, I'm just not emotional. Oh, quit lying. You're emotional because that's the way God created you. The only way that God can get to your spirit is through your emotions. The same people that say they're not emotional, let them buy a new truck. And let them park it out somewhere. And some car pulls up next to you, looks like it had chemo treatments. And they open the door up and they ding your new truck. Don't tell me you're not emotional. Let the saints lose. Don't tell me you're not emotional. Let your boss forget to pay you the overtime he owes you. Let the next door neighbor's kids trample through your garden. Don't tell me you're not emotional. You'll get emotional about something you love. Okay, all right, all right, all right, all right, all right. Jesus. Y'all ready? All right, here we go. Here we go. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Out of your throne room shall flow rivers of living water. Ooh. See, if I'm really got him on the throne of my heart, then there ought to be a flow of his spirit coming out of me. And if the church has him on the throne where he's supposed to be, that river should flow. I used to do a deal as an evangelist. It got me in trouble a lot of times, but I learned this principle, and I'm about done. I learned this principle to watch the congregation and watch the flow. And then when I seen places it wasn't flowing, I knew we got a dam here. We got something restricting the flow. At one church, there's a group of people sitting there, and I mean, brother, it hit that wall, and it just, and they were just like, you know. So they had a guy in that church, man, I mean, he was a live wire. I mean, you'd be preaching, he'd be running up behind you, he'd be all over the place. So I got him one night, and I said, come with me, I need you to do something. Now, I'm not a good pastor. You got a good pastor, but me, I lose patience with people. So I got the old boy, and I took him right back. It had been about this section. I'm not saying this is the section, but maybe my gift's working. I don't know here. And I said, now, from now on, as long as I'm here preaching, that's your spot. I said, you get in it, and you keep doing exactly what you've been doing. I put the emotional one in the non-emotional section, and they didn't like it. Like I said, I got a long ways to go to be like Jesus. So one of those guys got so mad at me, he come up after service, and I was coming off the platform, and he was standing here, and he looked up at me to point his finger. I mean, he was mad. He said, you. Yeah? This is what he said. He said, boy, I started feeling the burn in my toes. He said, boy, you need to learn how to feed the sheep. I said, excuse me? He said, you heard me. I said, you need to learn how to feed the sheep. So I just kind of leaned over him. I looked this way. I looked that way. And I said, I don't see any sheep up here complaining. Now, I got an old goat here mad about something. And that's when he drew back to hit me. He did. Now, I know a brother Brian, he'd let him punch him, he'd turn the other. I mean, he's a Christian. I'm not. I'm just telling you right now. I said, oh, don't do that. He said, what you gonna do? I said, I don't know. I've never been tested in this area before. You may hit me, I may turn the other cheek, but I don't think that's gonna be the outcome of this deal. I said, if you hit me, I may whip you all over this altar area. He said, some preacher you are. I said, well, some saint you are. You're the one that come here and started all this mess. Oh, yeah, I've got myself in trouble taking a stick of dynamite, throwing it right out in those areas and watching it just blow it up. Let me close. I went down one time, my dad, to his Aunt Florine, is my grandma's sister. She lived in a little farming community in southeast Missouri called Campbell, Missouri, and it was known for its peaches. And so we got to her house, and my Aunt Florine could make a mean hamburger. She'd crumble crackers in it and eggs in it. I mean, it was just out of this world. And so she's going to cook some hamburgers, and we were there. And I said, well, I want a drink of water. So she said, well, go over there and get it. So I walked over there, and I'm looking for the faucet. But it's not there. Got this weird-shaped deal. Got a spigot coming out. Got a handle coming out the other way. And I said, what's this? She said, that's water. I said, how this works. So my dad come over there and said, Mark, this is a hand pump. I said, well, how do you turn it on? And I looked up, and there was a little glass of water sitting on the windowsill. And I said, well, there's water. I'll just drink it. Oh, no, 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 no. You can't drink it. That's for priming the pump. Is for what? My dad said, watch this. So he poured a little water in it. He said, and so, man, I mean, I was, and it's kind of like, grr, 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 grr. He poured a little more water in there. Now a little trickle spits out. And then he put more water in it, and I mean, by then, man, it just gets to gushing. I'm a little concerned that the water that we produce does nothing more than prime the pump of the church, when it ought to be giving life to the community. All right, here we go. Here we go. Y'all ready? Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. I'm reading your mind. You know what I'm saying? Get away from me, preacher. Leave me alone. Ask me after church. Now, see, you need to start taking ownership for the pew you sit on. And you need to determine that when you come to church, you are going to be the source for that river to flow on your pew. A river of healing, a river of deliverance, a river of salvation. See, it doesn't flow from him. It flows from you. See, we expect the pulpit. Well, we want a celebrity to come in. We want him to call us out. We want him to do all the praying. That's not what Jesus said. He said, these signs shall follow them that believe. You don't have to wait for some hotshot evangelist to come in here and do all this stuff. You're supposed to be doing it yourself. Y'all with me? So here's what we're going to do today, all right? We're just going to get a river flowing. And you need to say it's going to start with me. Now, I don't know what the needs are here today, but I can promise you this. There's people here that need the Holy Ghost. There's people here today that need deliverance. There's people here today that need healing. And I'm convinced that if you get that river flowing, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. And when that river starts to flow, whoever is thirsty around you is going to get a good drink of living water, which has healing in its leaves. Ooh. So y'all ready? I want to know how many of you are going to own your pew. If you're going to own your pew, stand up right now. We'll do it the easy way. This is my pew, and I'm responsible. Boy, I think y'all ready to get out of here. You going to own that pew? I'm going to own this pew. Now, here's what we're going to do. I'll just be honest with you. I'm too old and too fat to pray for everybody anymore. So I've learned this. Let the people do what they're supposed to be doing. So I'm convinced that whoever is on your pew that needs the Holy Ghost today, if you just let it flow out, I just believe they'll get the Holy Ghost. Don't dam it up and be a reservoir. There's people sitting close to you today that need a drink of water and out of your belly. We good? I'm expecting people to get the Holy Ghost here today. I'm expecting people to be delivered here today. I'm expecting people to be healed here today. So here's what we're going to do, all right? You ever heard of the gifts of the Spirit? Well, some of you getting ready to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And we're going to take it out of the mystical. You know that. A lot of times we operate in the gifts of the Spirit, don't even know we're operating in it. I'm convinced that there's a practical approach to the gifts of the Spirit. It doesn't have to be mystical. So here's what's going to happen. You're getting ready to pray for somebody, and when you get to them, you're going to ask God, Lord, whatever their need is, I ask you to let me operate in a gift of the Spirit that would effectively minister to this person. All right? Covet the best gift earnestly. We put them into three categories, three, 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 and then we have to choose. No. The best gift is whatever's needed at the moment. I mean, that's the best one for the situation, whatever's needed at the moment. So here's what you're going to do. You're going to ask God to allow you to understand that the best gift that's needed to operate for me to effectively minister to this person, I want it to flow through me right now. Ooh, it locked up right there. Oh, I don't know, Brother Moore. Quit being fearful. Allow God to flow through you. Allow God to use you to minister to his body. After all, this is called the ministry of the saints. Fivefold ministry is to perfect you, to get you ready, to mature you, so you can do what God's called you to do. Not for us to do it for you. I'm trying to, and I know that he believes this, we're trying to empower you here today. Because if you can learn this in a Pentecostal service, which, to be honest with you, is one of the hardest places to exercise what I'm talking about. Because we've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly, and he missed it. But when you're out there and somebody looks at you and says, my wife was just diagnosed with cancer, you need to be reminded, and out of my belly shall flow rivers of living water. My son's bound. He's an addict. Out of your belly, you don't have to drag him down here to the church. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. I'm about to pray a prayer of deliverance over your son right now. I feel delivering power in this building right now. I said, I feel delivering power in this building right now. And guess what? It's going to flow through you. Ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost moving here right now. It's going to flow through you. Now, I want you to lift your voice, and I want you to start crying out to God. Yes, sir. I want you to start crying out to God. I want you to start telling, help me to effectively minister. Use me right now in any gift that you need to use me in right now. Ooh, I own this pew. It's going to start on this pew with me. I'm about to let it flow right through me all the way down this pew. I don't know what the needs are on this pew, but God's getting ready to meet the needs. Come on. That's it, come on. Now reach over, start connecting with people close to you. We're gonna get a momentum and a flow going right now. How good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together. It's like the dew that descended upon Mount Hermon. It just starts with you as a trickle, but when you connect, it starts creating greater momentum. Come on, that's it. Connect with somebody. That's it. Don't be autonomous here today. I'm just going to do my thing. No. Connect with somebody else. I mean, there ought to be a roar coming up out of this place right now. You ever been to Niagara Falls and heard that roar? That's how it ought to sound in the spirit. Go on, lift your voice. That's it, lift your voice. Spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. That's it, spring up, oh well. That's it. Receive you the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. Come on, you want that river to flow. You got to put yourself on the altar right now. Jesus' name. Jesus. Now, I want you to be led to go pray for somebody right now. Just look around, find you somebody, and go pray for them right now. And when you lay your hands on them, expect God to use you right now. Come on, don't let fear intimidate you. I don't know how to do this. It's easy. Just let that river flow out. Just let there be a breakthrough in your spirit. Just let it flow. That's all you got to do. Just let it flow. Woo, let it flow. Let it flow. Receive the Holy Ghost today in the name of Jesus. There's miracles in this building right now. There's miracles in this building right now. There's healing in this building right now. In Jesus' name. Years later, he comes.